My name is Annabelle, and I am the founding partner of the law firm Crefovi, which specialises in advising the creative industries out of London and Paris. One of the sectors that we cover is luxury goods and fashion, and we therefore have a roster of clients in these particular fields, luxury goods and fashion sector. I am also the president of the International Association of Lawyers for the Creative Industries, YALCI, and we organise seminars, webinars, events which are about business and legal issues which are relevant to the creative industries. So today I'm here to present a law and luxury course to you, in focusing in particular on the issues of intellectual property, counterfeiting, and ethics and the fair trade. So just to let you know how this it's going to work today, there's going to be three parts to this course. And sorry if I repeat myself. So as I mentioned, intellectual property rights is going to be the main topic we're going to study this morning. Then when we resume the course at 1:30 this afternoon, we're going to do a case study relating to what we have learned in the morning. And after the case study, we will be doing learning some additional knowledge on counterfeiting and the fight against it, and then on the fair trade and ethics. So intellectual property is a fast moving area of the law. It's also very important to foster creativity and innovation in an evolved society, in the sense that there is a virtuous circle of creativity and innovation, whereby an offer is stimulated into being more creative and innovative, because firstly he knows that there is going to be some important protection of his intellectual property, and also that he's going to reap the rewards of his intellectual property by being able to monetize it. So this creativity and innovation from any offer is going to foster the development of our society as a whole, since it's going to benefit from additional creativity and innovation. France is a great example of this, I think, because it has an enormous amount of know-how in the luxury goods sector, and the fact that its intellectual property system is very, and legal framework is very strong, makes it a favorable environment for offers, so in the sense creative designers, fashion designers, craftsmen, to actually be more creative and innovative, especially in the luxury goods sector, and therefore that benefits to France as a whole, since the luxury goods sector is very often associated with the nation of France, for example. That's just an example. So intellectual property is intangible, which means that you can't touch it. The best example of this is to say that what is set out in a book is what we would call intellectual property, but obviously the book which contains all this knowledge is a tangible asset. That is tangible property. So intellectual property, intangible, the book that contains all this intellectual property is a tangible asset. Intellectual property may take a lot of time and effort to create. For example, it takes time to write a book or produce a TV show or a film, but it's very easy to actually copy and infringe just by using a reprint or a digital copy. So because intellectual property is intangible, because also it's easy to reproduce at a minimal cost, it really needs to be protected quite heavily, as in a way it is something which can be easily stolen. So what intellectual property rights are available, in particular for the luxury goods sector? Well, the first one is patent. A patent is a statutory right that gives the patent owner a monopolistic right to use an invention which has an industrial application. So, for example, a very simple example, I see that all of you have got computers almost, and that's great. the person who created a computer, I'm sure, got a patent on that. It's just a very simple example. Now, the second type of intellectual property right that you can benefit from as an offer is a breach of confidence. So, whenever you enter a contractual relationship, very often there is a confidentiality clause set out within that agreement, that contract, which provides that as a party to this contract, you are not supposed to actually divulge this confidentiality information to third parties. So if you actually breach this confidentiality agreement under your contract, then that would be a reason to actually sue you and obtain some damages for breach of confidence. For example, in the fashion industry, creative directors luxury maisons, houses, I'm fairly sure that in their employment agreement or in their freelance agreement, sometimes they're not employees, sometimes they are freelancers, like Karl Lagerfeld, I think, he's a freelancer with Chanel, he's not an employee of Chanel, for example, if I remember well. But a creative director would most definitely have in his the agreement which bounds him to the fashion house, to the luxury house, a confidentiality clause which sets out that he cannot divulge any information about the new models or the new designs or products which are coming out of the luxury house in advance before they are being released to the public domain. So if he does, it's a breach of confidence and he could be sued for that. Another and very important intellectual property right in the fashion and luxury goods world is trademark. A trademark is a statutory right that gives the exclusive right to use a distinctive sign. So for example, a name, a symbol, a scent, a logo, a jingle could be a trademark. So for example, the words parce que je le vaux bien, because I'm worth it, from L'Oréal, that is trademarked. So that trademark is very useful for consumers, because whenever they actually see this brand in the market, they can recognize the logo or service that is being provided, and also which company is providing such product, and therefore, if the trademark, if a brand is famous, this will trigger some confidence that it is worth buying this product or service. So trademark is very important, in particular in the luxury goods sector. It is really an important part of the intellectual property of a fashion or luxury house. Passing off is an English law intellectual property right mainly, and it's quite interesting. So goodwill is a form of property constituting the market's perception of the value and quality of a business and its products. So this goodwill can be protected against interference or damage by passing off. This intellectual property right of passing off. So passing off is a tort that may be used in preventing a trader from making misrepresentations which damage the goodwill of another trader. So let me give you an example, because that's a bit dense as a definition. Recently in the legal press, there's been some talk about Brooks Brothers, an English menswear company, which had been sentenced to paying some damages to another, to a competitor, another menswear company called WS Foster and Sons. So both these companies are based in the UK, and Brooks Brothers in particular has around 70 nationalities, people from different 70 different nationalities coming to its store to actually do some purchases. So it's, despite it's a brand which is mainly based in the UK, Brooks Brothers, it's known all over the world in the menswear field because so many people come to buy from him. And what was interesting is that Brooks Brothers purchased in the early noughties a logo from Peel & Co, which was another menswear company which had gone recently bust. And the logo that they purchased was a boot and a fox logo.
Is it possible just to write down the name of the company so I'm just spell them slowly?
Sure. Over here? Is that good? Okay. So that's Brooks, Brothers versus W.S. Foster and Sons. On this note, actually, thank you for your comment, very judicious. During your lunch break, I'm going to send you a little summary of what we are talking about today, because it's quite a thorough, and also I understand it's a new topic for you. As Ms. Michaud has told me that, as far as I understand, you've not studied intellectual property before. So, although I do urge you to still, you know, pay attention to what I'm saying right now, I'm going to send you also some more detailed notes during your lunch break, so that you can also benefit from them while you are doing your case study, okay? So some of the names will be set out on there. All right, so going back to my case. So as I was saying, Brooks Brothers bought that logo, the Fox and Boot logo, and for several years, in the beginning of the noughties, they didn't really use it at all. In the meantime, an ex-employee of Peel & Co, which, as I mentioned before, had gone bust, went to work for W.S. Foster, and he suggested to his new employer to actually use that book and fox logo, that boot and fox logo, because it had you know, a lot of clout, and they did. W.S. Foster started to use that logo, the boot and fox logo, although it had not purchased it, but it used it nonetheless, and built its reputation and goodwill on that around this boot and fox logo, generating actually quite a lot of goodwill out of this. And then in 2005, Brooks Brothers, which, as I mentioned before, I'd actually purchased the boot and fox logo, opened some new stores, and in these new stores they started to actually use the boot and fox logo. Subsequently, they were sued by W.S. Foster for passing off, and they actually won in front of the English court. So the decision was published a few weeks ago, and it was quite interesting to see that because they had not used that boot and fox logo for several years, they had actually lost the right to use this boot and fox logo for non-usage. They had not developed the goodwill, Brooks Brothers, around that boot and fox logo. So when they started to use it, they were actually passing off in terms of using the goodwill from W.S. Foster.
Doesn't that invalidate the whole process of registering a patent or a trademark?
Well, it's a very interesting. But the question was, does it not invalidate the process of registering a trademark? No. When you actually register a trademark, and we'll come to this later this afternoon, but that's okay if we mention that now. When you register a trademark, you have an obligation to actually use your trademark. If you don't use it, after a certain period of time, in many jurisdictions, you actually lose the right to this trademark. So, in this case, anyway, you can see that passing off is still very much a tort which is applicable under English law. Right, so now moving on to copyright and moral rights. A copyright is a statutory right subsisting in original literary, dramatic, musical and artistic works, which are often referred to as LDMA, for literary, dramatic, musical, artistic, LDMA works. And copyright also exists for sound recording, film, broadcast, and the typography of published editions. So these are called the entrepreneurial copyright. The owner of a copyright has a number of economic rights on his works, including the right to prevent the unauthorized copying and adaptation of his work, obviously. And there are also some moral rights attached to copyright, in the sense that moral rights are rights that the authors keep, retain in their works, irrespective of who owns the economic rights. So for example, when a collector buys a painting from an artist who is, let's say, a contemporary artist, someone who is still alive, the economic rights, obviously, of his painting goes to the collector, who is the owner of the painting. However, the moral right attached to that particular painting remains with the contemporary artist, the artist or the painter, who will, for example, have to give the authorization to diffuse, to publish the picture of his painting in books, in the press, in on the various types of media. So that's an example of what moral right is and why it remains with the offer of a copyright. And then last but not least, design law. So design is the overall visual aesthetic aspect of a product. That is what design is in relation to design law. And certain functional and aesthetic aspects of the appearance of articles are protected via a combination of registered design rights and also design rights, which are unregistered design rights, and also some aspects of copyright law. So designs are quite well protected, in particular in the European Union. So just to recap again, in terms of design law, we will see this in more details later, but there's a registered design, which is the exclusive right to use certain aesthetic or functional features of a range of products. Then there is a design right, which is non-registered, which is the right to prevent the copying of a functional aspect of the shape or configuration of an article, such as a manufacturing tool. And then there is also copyright, which protects design, and it has copyright as a residual role in the field of design law. More on this later. Intellectual property rights are governed at the national level. So, for example, in France, you've got a certain set of intellectual property rights. In the US, you also have another set of intellectual property rights, and they are all governed by the various countries. However, in the European Union, intellectual property rights and in IP law in general has been harmonized at a European level thanks to various directives and regulations which apply to the IP field. So, for example, now it's possible to register a community design right or to register a community trademark, which would apply to the 28 member states of the European Union. Any questions at this juncture? I know it's a bit dense, so these are the two slides which are like quite intense, but then it should become more fun, hopefully. Okay, right. So, it's all very well to have some intellectual property rights, but at the end of the day, if you can't enforce them, they're not worth much. So the European Union in particular has made a point of providing offers with strong enforcement methods of intellectual property rights. And it's important to be aware of a range of civil remedies and even criminal remedies that one can have against the infringement of intellectual property rights. So if we look at final remedies. So basically, when I mean final remedies, I mean the remedies that are going to be granted by a court at the end of the process of a lawsuit, etc. This is a final decision that the court reaches, and that's called a final remedy. So I need to do a little technical break. Well, pecuniary remedies are basically the financial compensation for losses caused by infringement, and they may take the form of damages or an account of profits. So I'm sure you can see from the diagram that I've made that the top bit is pecuniary, so then it splits into accounts of profit and damages. So accounts of profit is an equitable remedy involving the award of a right holder to of the profits that the defendant has made from the infringement. So, for example, when an infringer of an intellectual property right has actually managed to get to make quite a lot of money out of his infringement, when these are ill-gotten profits, okay, and when these ill-gotten profits are above or exceed the normal amount of damages, then the judge can decide to actually grant an account of profits to the claimant who has won the case, if he has won the case, obviously. So that prevents unjust enrichment on the side of the defendant and the infringer. The account of profits is a remedy which is available for patent infringement, trademark infringement, actions of breach of confidence, passing off, copyright infringement, and infringement of design rights. But account of profits is not applicable for registered design rights when there is an infringement of registered design rights. And the standard financial final remedy is obviously damages, an award for damages. So this is the most, as I said, common pecuniary remedy for intellectual property infringement. And they are available within each intellectual property right. Someone, when an infringer didn't act as of bad will, he wasn't aware that he was actually infringing some intellectual property right, then the damages could be reduced to nothing, really. But sometimes damages can also take a punitive aspect and be much higher because the court wants to make sure that the infringer has understood the lesson and therefore is going to have to tap into his wallet to actually pay for the infringement that is made through punitive damages. Now, there are some other type of final remedies which are non-pecuniary. And despite the fact that they are non-financial, they are still really useful to fight against IP infringement. And the first one of them is called a declaration. So declaration is basically also called declaratory relief, which is a declaration of infringement on non-infringement, which can be ordered by the judge. So it is discretionary. So for example, you could have the obligation as an infringer to sit out in the press in a big newspaper, a national newspaper. I confirm that on this particular date I was sentenced by the court to this amount of damages because I was sentenced to infringement of these particular intellectual property rights. So that's quite full on. It doesn't look great in terms of your reputation if you have to do this type of declaration. Quite an effective remedy. Then there is also the non-pecuniary remedy of delivery up and destruction. So what is that beast? Well, it's actually fairly efficient. It means that the court can actually order to the infringer to actually bring all the infringing products in a place, and that all these products are going to be destroyed. Or the court can also make this infringer swear in court under oath that he will destroy the product himself. So also very efficient final remedy against IP infringement. Then there is also the option for the court to for a court to order for a party to reveal relevant information. Such an order could be ascertained, for example, could be made to ascertain, for example, the name and address of a supplier or an importer of infringing products. For example, some internet services providers have been ordered to reveal some relevant information about some internet sites or internet users who were selling some counterfeit goods over the internet. So that's an example of a court order for a party to reveal relevant information. And then injunctions as well are a very common remedy. And they are prohibitory in the sense that they can be used to prevent the initiation or continuance of an act. It's a court order, an injunction, and there are equitable remedies given at the court's discretion. So, for example, an injunction could be someone thinks that a competitor is infringing their intellectual property right, then goes to the court and asks for an injunction for this potential infringer to stop selling the products in his shops, to stop the marketing of his products. That would be typically an injunction. Now, interim remedies are also, and so we move on to the second type of remedies after final remedies. So interim remedies are also very useful tools because they allow the parties to act very quickly in case some infringement events are happening in the market. Intellectual property, as I said, is a fast-moving area of the law, and the reason that it is like that is because intellectual property evolves thanks to all the cases of IP infringement that we see on the street, you know, on the high street and in the luxury sector. Sorry. So basically, interim remedies are very necessary in the intellectual property field in order to stop, to put an halt to the infringing acts immediately. The most important interim remedy is the interim injunction. So I've just mentioned before what an injunction is. Well, you can even make an injunction an interim one, in the sense that when you make an application for summary judgment, it's probably going to take a few months, you know, before you actually get your judgment that this person has been infringing your intellectual property. But what you want really as a business person is that the infringing act stops now. And so therefore you go to court and you ask for an interim injunction that will be very helpful for the IP owner to stop the infringing act now, even before the summary judgment has been published. And that is a very efficient remedy for IP owners. And in fact, it is sometimes the only remedy which is being used, because a lot of IP infringement disputes do not go over they do not progress beyond the interim stage. So it's interim injunctions are super important for the IP law. Ex parte orders, I'm not going to delve too much into this because it's really complex, but what you need to know at the end of the day about ex parte orders are two things. The first one is that the important tools in the luxury sector in particular in relation to these orders are search orders, i.e. When there is a likelihood of a real and serious damage, clear evidence that there are documents or property at the alleged infringer's site, and a serious possibility that they will be destroyed if the alleged infringer is put on notice, then you can ask for a search order. And that allows the IP owner to go with customs or the police force to the IP infringer's house or business offices and actually search for any evidence of infringement and to be seized. And then a freezing injunction is the second type of ex parte orders that you want to know about. And these injunctions freeze the assets of an alleged infringer. And therefore, that means that he cannot transfer those assets outside of the country to other jurisdictions. Right, so these are the civil remedies that we've seen so far. Final remedies, interim remedies, civil parts. So that would be civil court that deals with that. But in certain jurisdictions, especially in Europe, actually, but also in Asia now, there are even some criminal sanctions which are linked to IP infringement. For example, the UK has recently passed a bill called the Intellectual Property Bill. In fact, just one day after the Queen's speech, so earlier in May this year, whereby now the infringement of registered or unregistered design rights is susceptible of being sentenced to by a fine and a prison term of up to 10 years. So they're not joking. I mean, for counterfeiting designs and trademarks as well, I think it also applies to trademarks, then you could end up 10 years in jail. France also has got some quite strong criminal sanctions in relation to IP infringement. And I think that the highest in terms of intellectual property infringements in France could be a fine of up to €500,000 and up to 5 years in prison. So, it's especially strong for pirates and counterfeiters, these criminal sanctions. And then last remedy that you can have for IP infringement is to fret. So you have, as a designer, you've got some suspicions that your one of your competitors is actually infringing one of your intellectual property rights. Then you can send him a cease and desist letter or a summons letter asking him to stop selling those infringing products. When you do this, though, I think you really have to err on the side of caution, because if it turns out that actually this competitor was absolutely not infringing your intellectual property right, you could be in a pickle, you could be countersued. But having said that, if you've got some strong evidence that this person is infringing your intellectual property rights, I don't think that you should hesitate in sending this summons letter. Quite recently, I had the case of some people who came to. I met them at a trade show at Tranoi, and they were from Taiwan, based in London, and they were making some wonderful eyelashes, very beautiful eyelashes. And they noticed they were selling them at this trade show. I met them afterwards in London. And they had actually patented those eyelashes, which were then placed in films like, it will come back to me, but Hollywood films. So these products were of very high quality. And they told me they had patented that product. They showed me that there was a high street retailer in London that was actually, you know, copying their designs, infringing their patents, but it was obvious. And I said to them, I really do think that you have a strong case. Despite this, I never heard back from them, and that's really a shame. I think that probably they were a bit concerned that they were quite small, they were quite tiny, and they were almost like at the startup stage. Although their beautiful eyelashes had been placed in films like The Hunger Games, so quite high profile. But they were, I think, quite concerned that if they were sending a summons letter to this very high street chain in the UK, they would end up being sued, I suppose. That's what they thought, and therefore they did nothing. But think about all the revenues potentially that they are losing, because this high street chain is selling very similar looking eyelashes. It's a shame. I think that most governments are thinking of making it easier for small fashion businesses to actually sue in case the intellectual property is infringed. Now, I'd like you to this was a hard bit. Now you can relax. We're moving on to something a bit more playful, so to speak. If you would please kindly circulate this around, we're going to have a look at that design, that drawing, and discuss about it. Right, so I need a bit of interaction from you now, because this is a little sort of small exercise so that we can sort of, you know, capitalize on what we've just learned. We are going to go in more details on very important intellectual property rights in a second, but first off, it would be good to just chill a bit and just have a look at this example. Okay, so what design rights might there be in my design work that I should know about? Do you guys have some thoughts about, for example, the intellectual property rights which are related to the hat of a lady on the drawing? I mean, or if you want to make some other comments about other particular garment or accessory she's wearing. I mean, for example, how do you think this hat is being protected in terms of intellectual property right? Or that's right, exactly. This, absolutely, well done, miss. The hat has a particularly type of design. You can see it's an original hat. It's got some innovation in it. So through the design law that we've mentioned before, even if it's an unregistered design, i.e. nobody's gone to the intellectual property office of a particular country to register it, there is some unregistered design right which is attached to that particular hat. And as I was saying before,
How can I know if there is a design right to particular for a particular product, or especially for this hat? So it could be a random hat.
Well, it depends of which where you want to register it, but there are certain criteria to get the registration of a design. But basically, when a design is different, it's a little bit different. Quite innovative, quite different. This is where, because there is some innovation, some creativity in your design, this is where you can actually have a design right which is attached to your design.
Who decides if there is innovation in this particular design or not? Like it's very.
Yeah, it needs to be. It cannot be a replica of some design which already exists. So it needs to have a little, you know, particular feature that makes it a bit different. So therefore, you can either, well, in any case, as I said, for design rights, you have got undesigned rights, unregistered design rights, so you don't have to do anything, but also you do have some registered designs if you wish, so you can also register your designs, and you'll get more protection, obviously, if you register your designs. But you see, there is also a little C for copyright, which is close to the D. So that also means that this hat has the protection of some residual aspect of copyright law to it. So the offer of this particular hat has also some copyright on the hat. So would you like now to have a look at the glasses? She's wearing some massive, you know, goggle glasses. What do you think about those glasses, for example? Right.
Because if you're a brand like Prada or Chanel, you can't, maybe not Chanel, but you can.
No, actually, yes.
Luxottica, mm-hmm. Which is known for glasses licensing.
Yes.
So you give them the right to exploit your brand name and to use it to sell your products.
Mm-hmm.
And you come to a part, they give you
a royalty. That's right, very good, well done. Exactly. Why it is also so important to protect your intellectual property rights? Because you can monetize them. If you protect them well, you can actually use those trademarks or patents or copyright to actually assign the right to use them to other people or other companies which are interested by them. Very good example, Luxottica, the biggest licensee of eyewear in the world, with Safilo is the second biggest. So two Italian companies, and they have so many licenses whereby luxury brands have assigned the right to use their trademark to these two big players. There are also some in France, which are a bit smaller in terms of licensees, but it's a very, very big market. And what is quite interesting with licensing, in particular trademarks, is that while you are assigning your right to use your brand logo and therefore trademark in relation to a particular class of products. So if I remember well, for eyewear, I think it is class 6 of the Nice classification of the Madrid protocol. sorry, of the Nice classification, apologies. So you give them the right to use your logo and your trademark in relation to a particular class, and then they start producing some eyewear on which this licensee will give back to you some royalty, which is usually between, I'd say, 3 and maximum 10%. So a lot of people aspiring to luxury goods cannot buy a Chanel tailleur suit straight away. It's so expensive. So what do they start with? Perfumes, eyewear, lipsticks, cosmetics. And this is where all the money is. And if I may express myself like this, if it's not a swear word to say luxury and money, but this is where the money is, really, because so many people can afford buying a pair of Chanel eyeglasses while they can't afford to buy the Chanel tailleur. And on each pair of eyeglasses with a Chanel brand, Chanel takes 10% of that, more or less. I mean, the royalty is probably around 5 to 10%. And if you multiply this by, I don't know how many, you know, millions of individuals in the world, that's a lot of money. And then these luxury brands then put some royalties, some money from the royalties back into the core of the business, which is, for most of them, the prêt-à-porter and the haute couture production and catwalk. So having all these sort of, not derivative products, but all these useful and judicious licenses of products in perfumes, eyewear, cosmetics, is very useful to reinforce the aura of a brand, because then you are not only sold in the Chanel boutique, but you also sold at Sephora or in various eyewear shops around the world and duty frees. But also it's good from a revenue standpoint. So, okay, and the same applies to the little bottle of perfume you can see on the right. Interparfum, Coty, and many others are also the very important licensees in the world of perfumes. Okay, so what about the what about the little print Louis Vuitton? You see, or you can see on the bag here, and then it brings to also L and TM. What do you think about that? This. Okay, this one is a bit complicated. So I'm going to explain, because there is one luxury brand which doesn't have any license. Only one in the world. It's Louis Vuitton. They do not have any licenses, okay? And you might have noticed that they do not sell perfume at this stage. Also, if I remember well, I don't think they even have some eyewear. I don't think that they produce eyewear. Do they? So if they do, they do it in-house. They do not have any licenses. So there is a mistake here, because it says license trademark. I didn't do that design, by the way. It's not me who's done the drawing. But license trademark, and it shows the Louis Vuitton logo. Well, that's not correct, because Louis Vuitton doesn't license its trademark to anyone. So that is incorrect. Sorry?
So what should it be? What letter here?
Well, it should be... I mean, if they want to show that it's licensed trademark, they should show another brand, because Louis Vuitton doesn't license its trademark. So, and actually, on this note, LVMH, the parent company of Louis Vuitton, has a zero tolerance policy on IP infringement and counterfeiting. And it's probably because, you know, if they don't license their trademark or intellectual property rights, because they don't want other people to actually use them. So, to come back to your question, miss, I think that licensing trademark and showing some logo is fine, but it should not be the Louis Vuitton logo. because Louis Vuitton doesn't, as far as I know, doesn't license its intellectual property. Now, one thing that I think would be quite interesting to have a look at is the skirt of a lady on the drawing. So basically, those little signs like that, they just show the print. So this refers to the print. So you can see the print, and then you can see LC. What do you think that means? LC on the print. No ideas? Okay, I have to move on, so I'll explain. Basically, I mentioned before that copyright can be either LDMA, literally musical, artistic, and literally dramatic, musical, and artistic works, but there are also some entrepreneurial copyright, which can be, for example, some typography of published editions, but also some prints. So basically, prints are covered under copyright. So a print designer has got a lot of copyright, obviously, thanks to all of his print archive that he has. And a print designer can also license his copyright to use a particular print. So by putting this L and then C copyright in relation to the print, that's what they are trying to explain. Okay? I suggest we move on. Right, so I said I would come back to some of the various intellectual property rights before, so let's have a look at that. So patents are governmentally awarded monopoly rights over some new inventions that are industry applicable, as I mentioned before. And the substantive criteria for a patent are some innovation, novelty must be present, and it must also have some it must be capable of industrial application. When you want to obtain a patent, because this is a national right, you have to go to your intellectual property office and apply for a patent. It is a long and costly process. Therefore, in the fashion and luxury goods industry, there aren't many patents which are actually applied for. But there is one sector which is an exception to that, and that is the field of underwear for ladies in particular, and bras. And I'd like to mention to you this very interesting case that settled last year, called Caterina Plou versus Victoria's Secret. Well, Caterina Plou is a lady who is an American lady who is a paralegal. And she came up with a wonderful invention, which is basically a bra that you can wear in many various ways, because you can actually cross the straps, or just put one strap, or cross the straps in the back or in the front, or just remove the straps altogether. And that was, you know, fairly inventive, innovative as well, and also it definitely had an industrial application. So she filed and obtained a patent on that bra with the US Patent Office. And then she approached quite a lot of retailers and distributors of women's underwear, and started to try to actually license probably a patent, or see what could be done to make a commercial application of this patent. So a meeting was set up with a VP, I think, someone quite high up in the chain at Victoria's Secret, but it was ultimately cancelled. So Ms. Plou was then very, very surprised, and even, I must say, quite shocked when she saw in the high street this Victoria's Secret very sexy 100-way brassiere coming up in the market. And for her, it really looked like a patented bra. So she sued. She sued back in 2008, and the Victoria's Secret filed a preliminary preliminary, sorry, injunction to actually stop the court case for saying that it was basically unfounded, that Victoria's Secret had breached the patent of someone completely unknown in the trade or something like that. And the court actually did not follow, and they did not grant the preliminary injunction to stop the case. So just before it went on trial, Victoria's Secret and Caterina Plus settled in 2012 for an undisclosed amount. So I believe today Ms. Plus doesn't have to work as a paralegal anymore. Okay. By the way, patents. Sorry, just 1 second. If you can bear with me. So a duration of up to 20 years. And obviously it's possible to sell your invention, to actually license it, as mentioned before, and to discuss also the invention with others in order to set up a business around that patent.
What does industrial application mean? Does it mean that it's only physical products that you can produce, or does it mean something else?
Well, I think it could mean also something which is, for example, although I'm not quite sure you can actually patent a service, but do you mean
a service or a website design or something that would be able to patent that? Because
I think that really, you know, in terms of website designs, that probably would be under the designer that you would protect it. If it's content of a design that would, of a website, that would probably be under the copyright that you would protect it. And in terms of coming back to your point about an industrial application, it means that basically this invention, which is new and has never been done before, needs to have some possible future use in the marketplace, that you could make some money out of it by, you know, making a product out of it.
Could be a service as well, for instance, that has industrial application.
I'm not.
Let's say you'd invented a new way of doing a facial or something.
Right. Yes, I think it is an interesting point that you have here, and I'll have to come back to you on this. Perhaps I'll do some research during the lunch break and I'll come back to you, because I think there's been some doctrine, we call it in French, so basically lots of articles written about whether you can patent a service or for example, or trademark a sort of, you know, a process, or say, I'll have to come back to you in terms of service. But usually, patents are much more filed for, especially because they are so expensive. You know, so you don't want to spend your money for nothing. They are usually filed for a product, something which is tangible. You know. Right. Okay. So trademark law, as I mentioned before, really important for the luxury sector. So a trademark, just to refresh your mind, is. So do you usually have breaks in between 10:30 or, I mean, how's that work? Do you want to go for a break so we go on until 12:30, okay, fine. So, a trademark is a sign capable of being represented graphically, capable of distinguishing goods or services from those of a competitor. For a consumer, a trademark is super important. I mean, I see, for example, most of you have got, Apple computers. So, well, from just seeing the Apple, I know that most of you like Mac. So for the consumer, a trademark is a really important way to actually recognize a brand and know, okay, well, this brand I really like, I trust them, I buy from them. It is really the essence of the luxury business. Conventional trademarks, as I said before, they are either pictorial marks such as letters, words, pictures, and drawings, but you can have some non-conventional trademarks such as slogans, because I'm worth it, parce que je le vaux bien, of L'Oréal, or three-dimensional signs, shapes. We're going to come to this in a second with the red sole shoe of Christian Louboutin. Some colors as well. Again, we'll see that with the Louboutin case. Some sensory signs, some jingles could be actually trademarked, or even a scent, a hologram. A trademark needs to be clear, precise, self-contained, easily accessible and intelligible, durable and objective. These are the criteria that have been set by the European Court of Justice in Ralph Silkman 2002 decision. The trademark can be enforced to protect the mark's owner against certain acts of unfair competition. In the European Union, it's actually possible for applicants to file a trademark application with a national intellectual property office, but I think quite a lot of trademark applicants are actually quite well advised to go directly to the organization of the office, sorry, of harmonization of the for the internal market, HOIM, because through a trademark application with HOIM, you can get a community trademark which will protect your trademark immediately throughout the 28 member states of the European Union. So I think it's also worth having a look at registering a trademark straight away with HOIM in the European Union. Okay, so I just mentioned to you that the trademark can be enforced to protect the mark owners against certain act of unfair competition. I'd like to come to a very funny and an interesting case of relating to trademark, which really was excited a lot of lawyers who love trademark. Who love the fashion world and are IP expert. Christian Louboutin. Christian Louboutin is a rather litigious man. He's been filing suits against many people. But before I mention this, I'd like to mention from the outset that he's registered a trademark of a red sole shoe in 2000. So this red sole was registered with the French Intellectual Property Office called INPI. And then it was extended globally to other jurisdictions by going through the World Intellectual Property Organization based in Geneva. Louboutin has decided to basically file lawsuits against anyone who commercializes and sells some shoes with red soles. So he started by actually suing Cesare Paciotti, the Italian brand, for unfair competition and trademark infringement and brand dilution because they were selling some women's shoes with red soles. He lost with the French court. Then he also filed a lawsuit against Eden Shoes, same reason. You made some shoes with some red soles. I'm suing you for unfair competition, trademark infringement. This time he won. That was in the early noughties. And
was it possible to lose one for the same kind of was it possible to win one city and then the next time should be the same rule and the same result? No?
Probably because the judges looked at the case. I don't think that he appealed all these particular decisions. So probably because the judges looked at the case, thought that the circumstances or the facts applying to this particular case were slightly different. So in the case of Eden Shoes, perhaps there were more criteria which made the judge think that actually they had used some of the trademark of Christian Louboutin to actually sell their shoes. It's possible that on the red sole, for example, they made also some inscription, put some little inscription which looked very much in the design of the way Christian Louboutin writes Christian Louboutin at the back of a red sole. I think it's also the way the judges interpret the fact and then look at the law. Sometimes, until there is a very strict case law which has been decided by the Cour de Cassation, which is the French equivalent of Supreme Court, then it means that all the lower courts can actually do a little bit what they want. And then it's down to the parties to decide whether they want to appeal, and to want a notch up by going then to the Court of Appeal and then to the Supreme Court, the Cour de Cassation. In those two instances, I don't think that the matter was escalated to the Court of Appeal. But coming back to the Christian Louboutin many legal sagas, he then decided to actually file a lawsuit against Zara, the Spanish brand of the retail giant Inditex. For the same reason, because they had made some red sole shoes that they were selling for 49 euros in the street to a raft of ladies, obviously, who loved them. And this time, Mr. Louboutin was in a pickle. Why? Because last year, probably around, March, April 2012, the Cour de Cassation decided not only that the Christian Louboutin could not have a monopolistic trademark over the color red on the red soles, and therefore could not pretend to forbid the use of red sole to any of its competitors. So all his claims of unfair competition, trademark infringement were just rejected. But he also got his trademark over the red sole cancelled by the Cour de Cassation. So he lost his trademark back in March 2012, the one that he had registered with INPI in 2000. That was cancelled by the Cour de Cassation because they thought that this trademark was not clear enough. That trademark was actually a semi-figurative trademark of the red sole, and the judges thought that it wasn't clear. When you look at the INPI register, they thought actually just by looking at the picture, I can't see that this is a red sole. It doesn't even refer to a Pantone shade. Pantone is a color reference system whereby you can say, okay, this type of red is actually numbered la da da da, a Chinese red, for example. It doesn't even refer in his INPI in his trademark to a particular shade of red. He can't really have a monopolistic use over any type of red for the red soles. Sorry. Ah, okay. Thanks. So that was a bit of a disaster for Yves Saint Laurent. For Christian Louboutin. Another aspect as well that the Cour de Cassation mentioned is that, look, you can't really say that those ladies who are buying some 49 euros shoes with a red sole are taking any share of your market, Christian Louboutin, because you are selling some red sole shoes which are worth 500 euros. So it's not exactly the same type of market that you are going after anyway. But as someone who likes the luxury products myself, I think this is not really a fair comment, because when I'm sure you know this, but in the fashion and luxury world, trendsetters are wearing and buying the stuff which is the most expensive because it's very new. But when everyone is buying the same thing, especially when it becomes much cheaper, then these fashionistas and trendsetting people are not going to put these products anymore. So I really do think that in this instance, if there are too many red sole shoes going into the street, yes, Christian Louboutin's shoes are going to lose some appeal, and the fashionistas are not going to buy his shoes anymore. So I think I can sympathize with his point. So while all this was going on in France with Cour de Cassation and Zara winning that particular case, well, Christian Louboutin had also filed another lawsuit, this time in the US, with the New York State, in fact. Christian Louboutin one day in 2005 was walking down, I think it's Park Avenue, and saw in the window shop of Yves Saint Laurent a monochromatic red shoe, i.e. the upper and outer parts of the red shoe were completely red. And he went bonkers and he filed a lawsuit again against against Yves Saint Laurent because for basically trademark infringement. And he requested a preliminary injunction to prevent the luxury goods competitor Yves Saint Laurent from marketing those monochromatic outsole upper red shoe. The judge Marrero from the US District Court of the Southern District of New York decided to not grant that particularly preliminary injunction. Firstly, because Judge Marrero said that it's not possible to actually trademark a color. He said that. And secondly, because that particular red sole trademark lacked secondary meaning, i.e. he didn't, according to Judge Marrero, he's probably not a fashionista himself, it didn't have any meaning or a particular reference to the brand Christian Louboutin. So basically, Judge Marrero could not connect the various dots to the facts, and therefore decided to not grant the preliminary injunction. Of course, Christian Louboutin appealed, and the Second Circuit Court of Appeal of New York decided in September 2012 to apply the everyone wins method, whereby basically the Second Circuit of Appeal, the Second Circuit Court of Appeal, confirmed that the trademark of Christian Louboutin over the Red Sole was valid. So I suppose in Christian Louboutin's in-house legal team, everyone was relieved to hear that. So his trademark over the Red Sole, at least in the US, is valid. However, according to the Second Circuit Court of Appeal, he cannot have a monopolistic right to basically prohibit other shoemakers from selling shoes which are monochromatically red. So when the shoe is completely red, the Court of Appeal decided, then this is not infringing the trademark of Christian Louboutin. Because, a lot of people in the legal press said, well, this is kind of a kiddie decision. I mean, that's what you say to kid, yes, you can do this. And then you said to the other kid, no, well, he's got the right to do that, but you can't really do this. So it was a bit everyone thought it was a bit of a weird decision. But basically, the bottom line is that Christian Louboutin has a valid trademark of the Red Sole, but Yves Saint Laurent was not infringing that Red Sole trademark because his whole shoe was monochromatically red. There was a big sigh of relief in the retail community and the luxury sector in general, because quite a lot of brands have actually trademark colors. So it was quite important for them to get the confirmation that one can register a valid trademark over a color. For example, Tiffany has had a trademark over the color Robin Egg Blue since 1998. And the retail giant M&M's has also trademarked the color yellow. So that was a good decision for the consumer goods industry in general.
Did he apply for another trademark of a particular shadow of red, or?
It's interesting you're asking this, because basically when I was preparing this course, I saw, because I wrote an article about it, which I set out on your mailing I sent you before this course, I looked at the INPI register, where you can easily find all the trademarks which are registered in France, and his trademark is still there. So I wonder, how probably his legal team then went to the INPI and, asked them what they had to do to actually reinstore this trademark. Because otherwise, it's quite terrible as well. If you've taken a trademark in 2000 and they invalidate the trademark, it means that when you re-register the trademark, you lose that particular date, which was set in stone, which was back in the in 2000, from when your trademark was protected. If you have to retake a trademark, it means that 10 years later, you're much more at risk of having that trademark infringed, if you see what I mean, because there's a very important rule which applies, which is that basically the owner of a trademark is the one who's registered the trademark before. So coming to your point, I don't know actually, it's quite blur. I looked on the website of INPI and the trademark was there. But one other thing that was set out in the various articles and in my article as well about these decisions, Christian Louboutin versus Zara, is yes, what he needs to do is to register a trademark which has got a much better picture, which is three-dimensional. You can really see that it's a three-dimensional picture of a red sole. It is important that he makes clear what particular shade of red he is protecting through that trademark, using, for example, the Pantone system, and he needs to be much more specific. That's what the court was after. So, but I'm not quite sure it's been done yet.
How many people are working in the legal department of
I don't think they are that numerous.
How does it work? It's externalized as a service and you have a small, like, couple of people inside, or?
Well, as far as Louboutin is concerned, yes. He's got a few lawyers who work with him. So it's done in-house, but for a court case, they can't represent themselves, so they take some external counsels, like myself, to represent them in court. And they work hand in hand with the top management of a brand like Christian Louboutin, so basically with Christian Louboutin himself, and the legal team. Yeah. It would have been also quite a disaster for Christian Louboutin to have lost his trademark, because that trademark was also licensed. Christian Louboutin was himself the individual, the natural person. Christian Louboutin was the owner of that trademark of the red. So he had licensed it to his company, Christian Louboutin SA. So basically, Christian Louboutin SA, the company, was doing all the shoes and doing all the business. But so in terms of structuring all this, it meant that it was an enormous amount of work to do to restructure. Take the new trademark, do the licensing agreement again, redo all the agreements. It's a bit of a nightmare. But all these things, you know, they don't really go public. There's been this decision which had to go public. It was the one decision published by the Cour de Cassation. But then what happens behind the scene and in terms of follow-up to that decision, they don't really want you to know. So. Okay, right. Copyright. Now, I think I'm just going to skim through and go a bit faster because we've got 10 minutes left. Copyright is also a very important intellectual property right for the luxury sector. I think I've explained quite in details before what a copyright is and what it can be taken on. But if we and oh, by the way, there's no need to register a copyright in Europe. So whenever there is a new work which has been created, then it's automatically protected by copyright, and that's good actually for authors. It's very protective. There are certain jurisdictions, like for example the US, where if you do not register your copyright, then you cannot sue for a copyright infringement. So that means that although it is not compulsory to register your trademark, your copyright in the US anymore, if you do not do so, then you won't be able to sue for copyright infringement. You won't be able to ask for some damages for the payment of your lawyer's fees. So it's basically useless. You do have to register your copyright in the US, which is actually quite problematic for fashion designers, because you know fashion is so seasonal. You registering your copyright every 2 or 3 months is kind of a hurdle in the US. We'll come back to this in a second. Right, so in terms of the copyright, specificities. A copyright is exists from the moment where the work has been fixated and is tangible. So, for example, you can't copyright an idea. It needs to be actually set out or written on a document or on a PowerPoint presentation or whatever support, whatever tangible support, and that the content on that particular tangible support is copyrightable. You see what I mean? And there's one particular area where copyright can be complicated. What happens when an employee of a company creates the work while he's actually working there in the company? Who owns the copyright? There's been a very interesting case about that in the luxury sector, its conclusion quite recently, that I'd like to talk to you about. But first, I'd like to give you a little bit of a legal framework surrounding this issue of ownership of copyright and the employee offer. The main rule is that the primary offer of a work is the owner of a copyright. This is the basic rule. However, in certain jurisdictions, like for example the United Kingdom, whenever the offer of a work is an employee of a company, i.e. he's been making the particular work while working in that company, then it is actually his company that will be the owner of a copyright. This is the principle under UK law. And if the employee wants to absolutely keep his copyright under a UK employment agreement, then there needs to be a clause set out explicitly in this English law governed employment agreement, which explicitly provides that the copyright of the employee will remain his. In France, completely different system. France has always been very, very protective of intellectual property rights, and the principle that applies to employee offers is that the employee who creates a work within his, the execution of his employment agreement remains the offer, the primary offer of his work. But there is, so let me talk to you about this this case law, case of Thierry Berthelot versus Van Cleef & Arpels. Thierry Berthelot has been working, had been working for many, many years for Van Cleef & Arpels out of Place Vendôme. Van Cleef & Arpels was bought by a particular investor, and they changed management. And during this process of changing management, they decided to have a due diligence process, probably, and they looked at all the employment agreement. Oh! And they noticed that there was no clause set out in the employment agreement, this French law-governed employment agreement, which set out that the copyright of produced by all these Van Cleef employees was actually ultimately the property of Van Cleef & Arpels. So they decided to approach all the employees with some assignment agreement of the copyright, so that these employees from Van Cleef & Arpels would sign this assignment of their copyright to Van Cleef & Arpels. One of the Van Cleef employees refused to sign, and that was Thierry Berthelot. Subsequently, he was fired. And he started to, he filed a lawsuit against Van Cleef & Arpels for copyright infringement. He also had taken lots of designs, actually. We just left Van Cleef with lots of designs as well. And 2 weeks ago, I think, quite recently, there's been a decision from the Paris Court of Appeal, which finally has shed some light on this case, because it's been going on for many years now. And what the Paris Court of Appeal has decided in its decision of earlier this year is that they applied the doctrine of collective works provided by French copyright law. Do you remember that I said to you that under French law, an employee who creates some work during the course of his employment is the primary owner of the work? That is the rule. There is one exception to this, and that is collective works. So, according to the Court of Appeal, each drawing at issue is the particular contribution of the employee to a collective work whose purpose was to create a model of jewellery. For neither of the drawings for which Mr. Berthelot claims ownership, he could prove that he had had a real creative autonomy as well as a freedom in aesthetic choices, which could have given reason for him being the sole owner of copyright on these drawings, reflecting an expression of his personality. So the court concluded that the drawings were mere contributions to the overall global creative process which was supervised by Van Cleef & Arpels. The jury had to be regarded as collective works owned by Van Cleef & Arpels, and therefore the Court of Appeal decided to deny Mr. Berthelot's copyright and consequently rejected his claims for substantial damages, actually. By implementing this rarely used, I'd say, doctrine on collective work, the courts made a pledge of judicial security for the fashion and luxury industry. And a lot of big jewelry houses around Place Vendôme really felt quite relieved when they read the decision from the Paris Court of Appeal, because otherwise it would become quite unmanageable, really, from a business standpoint. So, yeah, tough luck on this one for Mr. Berthelot. Any questions on this? Okay, so almost there before our lunch break. I think I've been fairly clear before that designs can be registered, can be protected through design law, which are unregistered design rights, or registered designs, which can be taken at the national level, and they will only protect designs within a particular state, or you can also register them at the EU level through a community registered design. And also, as I said, there's also a little bit of residual copyright in designs in the European Union. But one point which is quite interesting about design law, and which shows you that, you know, in the European Union we are really quite protected in terms of creativity and innovation. If we compare the situation of the European Union with the one that exists in the US, especially for fashion designers, we note that so far the American legal framework has refused to protect fashion designs. I mean, yeah, designs with some innovation relating to the fashion and luxury industry. So a lot of lobbyists in America, one of them being the Council of Fashion Designers of America, the CFDA, have tried for many years to actually present a bill in front of Congress to get some type of copyright protection for fashion designs. Well, they've not succeeded yet, and they've been trying to introduce three bills since, I'd say, 2009. Yeah, since 2009. So the first one was a bill for Design Piracy Prohibition Act. Then in 2011-2012, it was the Innovative Design Protection and Piracy Prevention Act, IDPPPA, and now the Innovative Design Protection Act, IDPA, has been presented in Congress. And probably due to the strong belief of the American people and that of free enterprise and free trade, so far it's just not made a ripple. The politicians, they are not interested in protecting fashion designs and designs for the luxury sector.
How can we define that, for example, it could be a registered design, but at the same time, it could be just a trend of fashion trends?
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think that a fashion trend triggers any intellectual property right. As I said before, you can't protect an idea. You can protect the content of a book, for example. It needs to be fixed, you know. It needs to be fixated on something. I wouldn't see how, you know. In any case, the trend is done by many people, right? And many people who decide to go into this trend. So how could one person pretend to be the owner of this trend or the creator of such a trend? Do you know?
For example, let's say your new look is back and then.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. Back, then, yeah. New look is belong to Dior. So mm-hmm.
Okay, it's quite interesting you're saying, actually. Well, so the question was, New Look was created by Christian Dior back, I think, in the 50s, if I remember well. And is that protectable as a trend? This trend was represented in a tangible manner by some designs, right? Those designs are going to be protectable under design law, as I mentioned. If Mr. Christian Dior had written articles about, oh yeah, now there is this new trend which is called New Look, and our collection, which is on our press book, in articles, are actually New Look. Everything that is written on this press book, on the articles, on the billboards, that was copyright protected by copyright. Okay. What else could actually protect the new look? I think that's, well, it could also perhaps even, although, you know, back in the 50s, I don't think I would be doing those things, but today, if we could apply the situation today, if he invents the term new look, well, he could trademark this, a bit like L'Oréal did for the expression, because I'm worth it, parce que je le vaux bien, this has been trademarked. So new look could also be a trademarkable, expression. Name, so therefore nobody else could actually use that word new look without the consent of Christian Dior. But what actually in this particular case, what Christian Dior did to protect himself, so to speak, from intellectual property infringement, he started to sell his models in America. because he was, especially as I just mentioned to you, fashion design is not protected in America. So therefore, he was seeing, you know, all of his collection, the new look collections in Paris were actually copied straight away and in America and sold in these big department stores over there. So so he started to sell in America to actually be able to reap the profit of having created the new look. Have I answered more or less? Yeah. Okay. Right, okay, I think that this is it for me at this juncture. So I shall see you at 12:30, sorry, I meant 1:30 p.m. Welcome back. So something I forgot to ask you before we went to our lunch break is the following. According to you, do you think it's preferable for luxury good companies to protect their intellectual property rights from the inception of these newly created products and services? I mean, do you think that luxury businesses in particular should allocate substantial resources and time to register those trademarks and patents and designs and copyrights? What do you think about these various questions? I know you are digesting like I am, but perhaps if you could have a bit of interaction. Well, if it's unregistered, then there's not much you have to do. You just have to have a record of what it is that you have created in terms of copyright and designs. But I'm talking more about where you have to take a proactive, the intellectual property rights, where you have to take a proactive steps to actually protect them, like patents or registered design rights, or trademarks. Do you think it's worth the investment after all we've discussed this morning? Yes?
Yeah, I think it sounds like it's worth the investment, but it does sound like you have to be willing to stand behind it and be proactive about protecting it, because if you don't...
That's very true, yes.
It's almost not
worth it, yeah. And it's a very good point, especially since... and this is probably why large luxury houses and conglomerates have actually some very, very strong in-house team who mainly deal with, you know, problem of IP infringement on a daily basis. For example, LVMH has a counterfeiting team whereby, you know, as I said, they've got a 0% policy on counterfeits and IP infringement. So that's what they do all day. Look at websites, they just, you know, send cease and desist letters to potential infringers. We'll come back to this, but it's fairly intense. I mean, there was even this artist called Zeus, who actually uses some trademark logos, such as Chanel or Louis Vuitton, in his street art. He's a street artist. And, he was approached by... the various luxury houses that he was using the trademark of actually sent him some letters to say, stop that or we sue you. So it's just an example, Deus, but there are some other artists as well that have been sent some cease and desist letter by luxury houses because they don't want them to use the intellectual property. All right, now, so we're moving on to the case study that I promised you we will be doing. So... I think that it would be good if you regroup in groups of I don't know, perhaps two, three. I leave it up to you who wants to congregate with whom. And then we've got around 10-15 minutes to basically have a look at that and answer those questions. So if you would like to pass these documents on in little groups. So you've got around four or five documents to have a look at. I mean, I think that, you know, that's what we lawyers do all day, i.e. we've got rafts of documents to read and we have to actually make sure that we read them quickly maximize our time. So here you also have to make sure. So there's not enough for everyone in the room, so I'm sorry to say. So this is why you have to keep the set of documents, just one for each group. Yes, and then you dispatch, I suggest you dispatch the work between you in terms of reading the documents. And at the day you regroup to, at the end of the reading, you regroup to answer those questions. What are the expected outcome on this case study from you is that I would like you to be able to have like 2 or 3 minutes presentation answering those questions. So which intellectual property rights owned by Gucci? Gucci complained Guess had infringed. What was the evidence that Gucci used based on the Gucci's complaints? And which Gucci provided to the courts in the US and Europe? So what was the evidence provided on behalf of the IP infringement? What was the defense strategy of Guess? The third question. And lastly, what was the outcome of the lawsuits in Europe and the US? And how do these decisions differ or confer?
Gucci filed a lawsuit against Guess for infringing their trademarks, which was amongst the what was it, green, red, green stripe of Gucci, the stripe that they have.
And then they also have the locked, double locked logo, interlocked logo of
G
Gucci.
Logo, as well as the stylized Guess signature, which exactly. Gucci claimed they had stolen from them or taken a little bit too much inspiration, basically.
Even also from the logo, they sort of use the same type of font, like that looks very much the same. So
yeah. They've also used the same Gucci motif, yeah. As Guess.
And as evidence of the infringement, Gucci...
So in terms of a logo, so what intellectual property right are we referring to?
Specific... trademark patterns, that like the G, basically the G that...
The G trademark
that Gucci says owns for the diamond pattern and... their GG logo in general.
Good. Are there any other intellectual property rights you think have been infringed?
The use of color, the red, green, red stripes, that they say is also another trademark, and they said that in another company had specifically referenced the shoe containing that stripe pattern to be used in one of their shoes, and they found evidence of that in an email. So that was actually one of the evidence that they used.
Excellent.
I guess that also infringed on some of the design rights, or like
yes,
the unregistered.
Very good.
For example, with yep. the shoe was almost identical in
correct.
Design.
Very good. Excellent. And have you noticed that reference to the term trade dress?
Yeah.
You've seen that?
Yeah.
Well, this is an American type of intellectual property right. Remember before this morning when we did the when we did the presentation, I mainly focused on EU rights, intellectual property rights, and I didn't mention trade dress. But trade rights really is the look and feel of a product. Basically it's the aesthetics, but it's not a registered right, and under US law it's called trade dress. And trade dress has been the type of intellectual property right which has been very often used by Louis Vuitton, for example, LVMH, to enforce its intellectual property rights against infringers.
All right, and then in terms of defense strategy of Guess, for the evidence? Sorry, the evidence of okay. Well, first of all, they used the past email that they have found, sort of discovered, that said that the company was referencing their shoes particular, mm-hmm. And then they used evidence of Guess products that were using specifically the G whether in their bags or in their patterns, saying that it was basically the similar to the Gucci G and was diluting the value of the Gucci logo and the Gucci
Very
brand. I don't know if you girls have found anything else additionally. No.
No.
Yeah.
I think they have filed complaints saying that it has an effect on like customers' loyalty to the Gucci brand. But then the court, well, at least in the US, they ruled that there's no evidence, like very clear evidence for that claim.
Okay.
Defense strategy of GAS. Well, I think I didn't read the
We have one email after in the U.S. after the court ruled that Gucci won the case. Actually, the CEO of GAS was basically saying that actually this case could have been avoided if Gucci has communicated with GAS in advance, and the amount of the amends that that the court ruled actually proved that the case is not as strong as Gucci claimed.
You mean the awards that they were awarded? The damages that they were awarded was not as high as if they had been super proactive, Gucci, and enforced their intellectual property rights.
Exactly.
That's true. This is a big important part of the US decision, that they damages would have been higher should they have been more proactive in enforcing their trademark. Don't you think that it's a bit cheeky to say, on guest part, to say, well, actually, you know, we should have told us, Alec, actually, that we were infringing the intellectual property rights. I mean, I'm sure guests knew that what they were doing. Good.
Exactly. Good. And then also in terms of the defense strategy, I think guests was claiming that because of other details of their product design, for instance, the hardware on the bags, which was very sort of bling-like and stuff, that the actual expression of the products was very different from Gucci's because it was more like Guess girl and bling than Gucci was. So then it didn't matter that they were using some of the same stylistic features.
Mm.
In terms of the defense, no?
Yes, no, I think you're absolutely right. They did mention this, but did it work actually? Did it work in front of the US courts, and did it work with strategy again in front of the European courts? What's your answer to the fourth question?
Well, I think it semi worked in the US because there they were actually awarded damages, although the damages were really, really small compared to what they had asked for. I think they'd asked for like in the order of 100 mil, and they got only 4.5 million or something in the end.
Mm-hmm.
So it was more sort of like a symbolic win, I would say. Whereas in the European courts, the case didn't hold.
In Italy, they have lost. In Italy, they said that they had their distinct product characteristics, and this is why they dismissed the case.
Yes. Well, I don't think that did they dismiss the case. I think that they just said, "Well, we reject your claims."
Yeah, they rejected the claims.
This is the first level of the court of the first level. So probably, I suppose that Gucci is going to consider appealing this decision and this Italian decision, and probably the Italian Court of Appeal will have to look at the case again, probably in 1 or 2 years' time. Sometimes in Italy, it's a little slow. Good. And what do you think? Do you think that this level of damages was fair? Do you think that? What is your view? What is your feel about this this case now that you've seen some of the evidence?
The problem with what they were trying to copyright was that the G literally has no part in the Gucci brand. It's just the first letter of their name, but it's not a specific font or specific kind of like a mark, whereas their double G is definitely more recognizable. So in that sense, Charlotte was also showing us the example of Hermès and Hogan, where they both use an H on the shoe, but can you really say, since they both start with H and it's not really a specific kind of H, can you say that, you know, one is...
Interesting. Was there actually a lawsuit between Hermès and Hogan?
No, I don't. I don't. I don't know. Okay. But I just know
that. Fair point.
Have you seen the shoes? If you look at the MS and the Hogan shoes, the man shoes, the sneakers, they're exactly the same.
Right.
They both have the age, which is a bit like.
Yeah.
And like tilted in their shoe. So, but in terms of Gucci and Guess, I think there is a quite high resemblance between the Gucci and the Guess font.
I agree.
And it's not only that they have quite the same G, but they have copied them, or there's a high resemblance in all of the stylistic features of Gucci. So I think that there is more of a case than.
Do you think that the Italian decision is quite surprising then?
Yes, I personally do think it's surprising.
It's probably because it's at the first level, as I said, and probably this is going to be actually appealed against by Gucci, and the Court of Appeal will take a more serious decision, so to speak. So we'll see. We'll see what happens, because that decision from the first degree Italian courts was published, I think, maximum 1 month ago. Thank you so much. Lovely. Thank you, everyone.